Good afternoon and welcome everyone. My name is Brigitte Rose and on behalf of Lung Foundation Australia, I'd like to welcome you and thank you for joining us for today's Live Well, Breathe Better webinar, proudly supported by Actelium. I would like to start by acknowledging the traditional owners of country throughout Australia and their continuing connection to land, sea and community. We pay our respects to them and their cultures and to elders past, present and emerging. Today, we are presenting a webinar on wellbeing for carers of loved ones living with pulmonary arterial hypertension. Focusing on the carer relationship, this webinar will explore the importance of maintaining carer wellbeing and identity. Before we get into introductions, there are just a couple of points to run through. The first one being that this webinar will be recorded, so if you do need to leave at any time or wish to refer back to the content as an ongoing resource, you can certainly do so. The recording will be hosted via our website, and if you've registered for this PAH webinar series, you will automatically receive a link to the recording via email. Secondly, I will just let you know that there will be a Q&A session held towards the end of the webinar, so we really encourage you to submit your questions you might have for our speakers throughout the presentation via the Q&A box. You can access the box at any time during the presentation, so please feel very welcome to ask as we go. Don't ever be afraid of interrupting. I will make a note of your questions and direct them to our speakers during the Q&A segment. I do believe you can submit questions anonymously too. So if there's anything you want to ask that's a little bit more sensitive, there is certainly a way for you to approach that as well. Now, we are very fortunate today to have two speakers joining us to share their wealth of knowledge and experiences and two very different perspectives as well. Our first speaker is Jane Mitchell. Jane is a PAH Clinical Nurse Specialist at the Royal Hobart Hospital. Jane is going to share with us some practical ideas for managing health and wellbeing, as well as gaining support and navigating through life with PAH. We'll then have Robyn Doyle, who cares for her daughter. Robyn will share her family's story, as well as her personal insight in managing the practical and emotional challenges of caring for an affected loved one and yourself. So without further ado, I will hand over to you now, Jane. If you'd like to please share your screen and introduce yourself to everybody joining us today.
Thank you, Brigitte, for your introduction. I feel honored to be having asked to speak today. And again, my name is Jane Mitchell, and I run the Pulmonary Hypertension Clinic at the Royal Hobart Hospital. I've been doing so since 2012, and I do run a statewide service. My clinic is between 150 to 180 patients, and 80% of those patients are female and ages 18 to 96. And they have pulmonary arterial hypertension anywhere from mild symptoms to severe. And I can't stress enough the importance of this topic in that being a carer is very, very challenging. And if you're a carer listening, you'll know that to be true. It's like taking a can of pickup sticks and tossing them up in the air and trying to pick up all major problems and trying to sort them out. And it can be very challenging. I have been nursing for 30 plus years, and I also have worked as a teacher in schools, but I also have been a carer for my mother who had dementia. And we moved in with her, my whole family, and we lived with her for 4 years. And again, from speaking from a caring position, it was very challenging. My husband, myself, and my two sons looking after my mother who couldn't remember what day it was, what time it was, and so forth. So I do have some experience of being a carer as well. And the stress that you can experience certainly is tremendous at times. And it's important to seek out information, important to seek out help as you need it. As we know, caring for a loved one intensifies emotions. And as a nurse, I have chosen a caring profession. You can have an 8-hour shift or a 12-hour shift and somebody takes over for you. And when you're going through difficult times, you have someone to back up. And when you're a carer, you are often landed that position. You didn't get a qualification for it. It just sort of lands in your lap, and then you just have to deal. You might be a wife, a husband, a mother, a father, a sister, a brother, a son or a daughter. You might be a friend or a next door neighbor. I do have patients with severe pulmonary hypertension who pretty much do it alone. And that's always, I often will tap into those patients a little bit more carefully. So chances are you have been a carer for a significant period of time, as often there is a delay to PAH diagnosis. And that PAH diagnosis is very challenging. So I do see the emotions that people experience. Not only the patient, but their carer slash loved one is like a roller coaster ride because of the chronic diagnosis that it is. When patients come to me for the first time, I always request that they bring their next of kin or their loved one or their significant other, and often that is their carer. And as we sit down for me to give them an education session on the condition of PAH and why it's happened to them, and I often will see a great sense of relief that they finally know what's happening and why this person is so short of breath and why they feel so tremendously fatigued with that shortness of breath. Those emotions then can lead to a bit of anger and frustration. Why wasn't this picked up sooner for my loved one? And again, it is a very rare condition that is often underdiagnosed or misdiagnosed. And I guess, as we say with the doctor that I work with, medicine is not perfect. And we like to work with the patient and their loved one in order to get the best result possible. Basically, as I said, when you're a carer, you haven't signed up for this. It sort of has landed in your lap. And some of the situations I've seen being in this area for 7+ years are a patient who had been the carer of her child all throughout the child's life, born with a significant condition. And as an adult child, that child had to switch from being cared for, who they still lived with their parent, and had to become the carer of the patient and learn how to operate a pump for pulmonary hypertension epoprostenol and how to mix up medication, and did so spectacularly. But then as time marched on, that condition led to being anxious and overwhelmed by their new role. And we had to ask the company that made that medication, could they help and find somebody who could actually make up the cassettes for the epoprostenol. And so I worked with that patient and their carer in order to try and ride through that difficult time. We are very fortunate in Australia to have such a wonderful healthcare in general. Again, the emotions that you can feel go on to feeling lonely or helpless because you might feel overwhelmed. And I know that carers that I have seen for a couple of young women who have been diagnosed with severe pulmonary hypertension is incredible sadness for that care because their daughter had been told that they should never, ever get pregnant because that could be fatal for themselves and the fetus that they carried. And so that great sadness that comes with loss of a future that you always thought would be, and the limitations that a chronic condition can have for a patient and their care. So the emotions are tremendous, and it is a very much of a roller coaster ride. Having said that, when I sit people down and I'm there on the other end of the phone, I say, how can we help you cope? How can we increase resilience? And again, at that first initial review, I say knowledge is power. And the more knowledge you have of that condition, the better. Now, everybody loves to Google. You know, we like to Google why we've got the headache, why we've got foot pain, and to see if we can come up for answers for ourselves. But I can't emphasize enough how I think it's so important with this condition that you stick to the websites that are really going to help focus on the condition of PAH, because up until 15 years ago, this diagnosis often came with a get your affairs in order, because we really didn't have any much help, and we didn't know how long that patient had. And so now we do have the website. In purple, I have PHA Australia, and they have a fabulous website of support for the person with pulmonary arterial hypertension, information for the cares and pathways and lectures and annual meetings that are happening. I also let them know this is a worldwide condition, and men, women, and children get this. And the UK has a really wonderful website, PHA Association UK. And they put out a magazine called Emphasis. And that magazine is really wonderful for the patient and their carer to not look at what has limited you so in your new life, but what can you enjoy, and focus on the cup half full versus the cup half empty, because it's easy to feel a tremendous loss. And this Emphasis really points out that information about what can you do versus can't you do. I do come from the USA, and the PHA Association, the third website down there, .org, has again a wonderful magazine that they put out quarterly as well. And in the recent article that I read in that particular magazine, the National Alliance for Caregivers gave out a survey, and 90% of the carers stated that they had to give education about that condition of pulmonary arterial hypertension to healthcare professionals, nurses and doctors, at some point in time. So as the carer and the patient, you're often educating the health professionals. And that's what came up from that survey. Also, two-thirds of the patients and the carers stated that they were being asked to perform medical duties, like pharmacists. They became pharmacists and nurses themselves, especially with that upping and downing of fluid tablets. If patients are on epoprostenol, that is a very challenging role. When I sit down with my patients to start that education, I say, you and your carer or your loved one are now going to get yourself a little nursing pen after we're finished here over the next 3 days, and a stamp of a pharmacist, because they are having to learn all sorts of new skills that, again, they never signed up with. It landed in their lap. And so that leads me also to that the Lung Foundation, which is I've put down in green, that is, again, a fabulous website that I list on the back of my little card that I give to patients. I list all three of those areas to focus in on, all four of those websites to focus in on and get information and seek help. So that leads me to that time to plan time for you as a carer. And it's that self-care that's so promoted these days, is how do we look after ourselves? And again, I can't stress the fact that as a nurse, my shift is 8 to 12 hours. And if I have problems, I can go to other fellow nurses. I can go to management. I can ask for some counseling when I have certain challenges that have come to me and other nurses. But as a carer, your job is 24/7. You're thinking about it all the time. And as I say in here, the essentials are that you try and get good sleep and regular exercise and maintain a healthy diet. And we know that once sleep goes, often exercise is impacted, and diets, you may stop eating or you might stress eat. And all of those things are signals that you might need some help. And it's tapping into friends and family to see how they might be able to help. And then really focusing on what exercise you like to do, whether it's yoga, walking, cycling, gardening, listening to music, taking time out to go to cinema with friends, taking a break from everything. Journaling, I think, is a tremendous help to just get a grasp of what was challenging in a day and how you might be able to gather. But it's focusing on time for you, something that refuels us rather than takes from us, is so important. So moving on, it's important that as a carer, that if you find yourself crying every day and you're feeling that you're really not coping, you need to ask for help because you are not weak. It's because you want to remain strong, you need to ask for help. And if that means going to your GP and asking for a mental health care plan, so you can go into a psychologist or a counselor and talk through some of those, that deep pain that you might be feeling because of the challenges that you're experiencing or the guilt that you might feel. You can call your clinical nurse specialist. I always state to my patients, call me. I work Monday through Thursday, 8 till 4. Leave me your name, your number, your concern, and help people get disability parking permits. So that leads me to Carers Australia. And again, I have had experience with my own family, extended family members who were hit with the news of a congenital health concern where they lost their 18-year-old son a year after he was finally diagnosed with a congenital condition that nobody knew he had. And that led to the whole family being aware that the mother was the carrier and the younger son also had the condition. And I can't tell you how much support they felt from Carers Australia, Carers Tasmania. And then the eldest daughter went on to work for Carers Tasmania. And so working with the new NDIS, which I know is no perfect system, I know since that big transfer, it's finding the help. And it's sort of an epic adventure into trying to make sure that you receive the care and support you have, whether that's receiving some respite, where you just pull off and have somebody else come in and care for that patient or that loved one that you have. That's just so important that you ask for help. Again, here we are in a time where we do know about self-care and know about mindfulness. And it's catching yourself sometimes through daily journaling that you know that you're really on a negative bent, and it's often at that time that you need to rethink, you know, stop yourself in your tracks with the glass half empty view and know, start to look for ways that you can also as a carer be supported with all that is out there to support you, because there are resources and there is information and you can tap into a lot of things that might be able to support you as the carer of your loved one with PAH. Thank you, Brigitte, for inviting me to speak. I hope that I have helped in some way on your journey. Life is short and we want to make it as sweet as possible. And life has its challenges, as we all know. And I wish you all the best in your journey. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jane. That was fantastic. We're really blessed to have you with us today. With rare lung diseases in particular, there just are very few people out there that have such a depth of knowledge in one condition such as yourself. So thank you very much. We really appreciate you joining us. I might hand over to Robyn now.
Thanks, Brigitte. Thanks very much. Hello, everyone. I'll just start off saying this. It's a bit of a long story here, as my daughter's 25 years old, and just probably bear with me a little bit. So I'm the full-time carer for my daughter, as I said, is 25. She'll be 25 in August. And my 90-year-old mother, who has multiple comorbidities, and my husband is the carer of his 89-year-old mother. Unfortunately, we don't receive any help from our siblings, so at times it can be very hard for us to care for the whole three of them. My husband and I only had the one child, Bridget, mainly because she spent 7 months of her first year of her life at hospital, which involved two operations on her heart. The first one when she was 12 days old, after going into heart failure, and she was weighing at that stage less than 2 kilograms. Also, we didn't consider it socially responsible to have another child. And at that stage, the geneticist was not 100% sure if it was a dominant recessive gene which had caused the problems. We did not want another child and endure what Bridget had already been through, and we didn't want to be torn between caring for one child in her at home and while another one was hospital, because even though Bridget's 25, in August, she has had over 80 admissions to hospital in that period of time. I have to sort of give you a bit of a history of how we got to the pulmonary arterial hypertension. It's a bit more involved with probably a normal person who has PAH. She was diagnosed at 3 months with a rare condition called cartilaginous syndrome. And that, compared to other people, taking 3 months to diagnose, that was relatively quick. That was sort of similar to people who have PAH as well. Sometimes it can take a very long time for the diagnose and can have effect on their treatment. The cartilaginous syndrome is a rare autosomal recessive genetic ciliary disorder and it comprises of sinus inversus, and all my daughter's organs are reversed, and she has dextrocardia as well. That means her heart is pointing, the apex of the heart is pointing to the right instead of the left in the body. Chronic sinusitis, in the future, infertility and hearing loss. And part of that cartilaginous syndrome is a disorder called primary ciliar dyskinesia. So she has four lung conditions. So the first one is the primary ciliary dyskinesia, which caused her congenital heart disorder, which caused her pulmonary arterial hypertension, which caused Eisenmenger syndrome. So why it's sort of important to talk about that is because the cilia are actually microscopic hair-like structures, and the cilia plays a very important role in the embryonic development. Any defects in the cilia cause problems with the formation and functions of organs, as in, like, she has a sinus inversus where all her lungs are, lungs are reversed, but all her organs are reversed. Plus, she developed a congenital heart disorder. And my daughter carries out the same chest physiotherapist, receives the same drug treatment related to the lungs as someone with cystic fibrosis. As I said, the congenital heart disorder causes pulmonary arterial hypertension. And I believe that she had developed that as a young child, probably after a second open heart operation that she had. But because she had, she's also got bronchiectasis and reactive small airways disease. And that was mainly with her younger years, she was always admitted for respiratory infections. So they basically thought, well, her low oxygen saturation, the best she ever got was 97%. And obviously when she got a respiratory infection, it went quite down. So her problems was she couldn't run very far. Because I remember in grade one, they had a junior school, small cross country. And my daughter in her grade one, at the two grade one classes, she came second last. But a friend who had cerebral palsy, she came last. And both my husband and I were both very athletic types in our younger days. But as I said, the doctors always put it down to respiratory conditions causing the shortness of breath and her oxygen saturations being sort of low on the normal size. Bridget did play tennis at school, but that was mainly due to the fact that the tennis, she played doubles, and also tennis is sort of a short burst of energy and then you have a rest. So in hindsight, it wasn't until I went to the conference at Dallas, Texas, 2016, the Pulmonary Hypertension American Association, that you're able to talk to a large number of different doctors who specialise in pulmonary hypertension. And I was speaking to one of the cardiologists there, telling him about her signs and symptoms and the fact when she was younger and doing one of the appointments to the cardiac thoracic surgeon, he just mentioned that on a chest x-ray that she had an enlarged right side of a heart. But they once again put that down to her congenital heart disorder causing that problem. But apparently that is one of the really early signs of could be of pulmonary hypertension. So if you ever want to learn a lot about pulmonary arterial hypertension, go to one of these American PH Associations conferences. They're held every 2 years, they're held over 3 days. The sessions are not only led by patients and carers, but they also have panels of doctors who are very willing to answer your questions. At the same time, at the same venue, they also hold the medical professions conference. So as a carer or a patient, you can actually go and sit in their sessions as well. But unfortunately, you can't ask questions, which are fair enough, because you've got plenty of opportunities to ask the doctors in the other sessions. It can be very overwhelming at times. There's so much information and trying to descend to decide which session to attend. We have nothing like that here in Australia, and I hope in time the LFA will fill this gap and all patients and carers have easy access to up-to-date information and support via diverse modes when it comes to PAH. Now, going back to Bridget, sorry. So I believe that Bridget always had a mild to moderate form of PAH. It wasn't until she was about 16, she went into hospital with one of her many respiratory infections. And usually by the end of the admission, after antibiotics, intensive physio, et cetera, her SATs would come back up to her normal. But the first admission she had in the November 2011, the oxygen saturations weren't coming up. And then she had another admission a couple of months later, same thing was happening. And eventually, it took 6 months, but eventually she ended up having the right heart catheter, the transesophageal echo, the vasoreactive study to the nitric oxide and bubble study. And then she was finally diagnosed with pulmonary arterial hypertension. And even then, there was confusion about what really caused her pulmonary arterial hypertension, because the cardiologist that back then at the Mater Children's was saying that it was idiopathic. But Bridget got transferred over to Prince Charles Hospital as this was a new diagnosis for her. And being 16, she got transferred over to the adult hospital. And her specialist at the time, but unfortunately she's now retired, she was adamant that her PAH was caused by a congenital heart disorder. Because when she was younger, with her heart condition, her lungs were being flooded by oxygen because she had no wall between the two atria and a very big hole in the ventricle septum. And when she had a pulmonary artery banding put onto her, it was a long time before they actually started to get tight. So what happens is apparently by flooding the lungs with that blood, it changes the actual makeup of the linings of the pulmonary arteries. So that's why they believe that her pulmonary arterial hypertension was caused by her congenital heart disorder. And her congenital heart disorder was caused by her primary dyskinesia. So it was caused by a genetic condition. And because of the pulmonary arterial hypertension, the pressure built up on the right side of the heart. It blew a hole through the calf pericardium that was used to form a wall between a septum between her two atria, and now she's got another hole in a VSD, a ventricular septal defect as well. So she's got mixing of her blood. So now her oxygen levels are between about 78% to 82%. So she uses oxygen overnight to sleep with. She has to use oxygen if she flies, when she exercises, and when she becomes very unwell. So that's probably a quick little summary of how we got to PAH. One thing is, like Jane had mentioned about people with PAH sort of not being able to, a risk of getting pregnant. I know some people do have pregnancies and everything's okay, but the fact that Bridget's got Eisenmenger syndrome as well, it's a definite a no-no for her to ever become pregnant. Therefore, being our only child, no no pregnancy for Bridget, no grandchildren. So you go through not only the grief of losing your own daughter at some stage, but never being able to have grandchildren as well, even for her, because she's always loved children herself. So, and they talk about, I just saw it late the other day on Facebook, they talking about being angry. And really, it's like they said, it's really more a form of grief. And the grief can, it's not something that sort of you get over in a short time, especially like us. We sort of really had that really bad diagnosis when she was first born, spent a month in the neonatal intensive care. They weren't sure she'd go and live and die and all that sort of thing. We got used to her going in and out of hospital with respiratory infections. That's just a new way of life. So that was okay. But then when she was 16, to be sort of hit again in your chest saying she's got pulmonary arterial hypertension, and the prognosis at that stage wasn't very good at all. And she had about 10 admissions that first year after being diagnosed. But I must admit now, the last couple of years she hasn't had admission to hospital. I don't know if that's because she no longer goes to school. Well, she obviously finished school back in 2012 and doesn't, not out there in nightclubs or, you know, big out working. She can't work, unfortunately, as well. So she's not been exposed to those viruses like she was at high school. And when Brigitte was saying for me to give ways of how to cope with this, the anger, the grief, the disappointment and that sort of thing, I was thinking, yes, I'm one of those people who can tell you what to do, but doesn't do it, unfortunately. I've done cognitive behaviour therapy courses, acceptance and commitment therapy courses, which involves mindfulness. I know how to meditate. But it's just about putting these things into place. It's been very hard with the SARS COVID infections, because I not only have my mother who won't go anywhere, but it's been very hard for Bridget as well. She now, because Queensland's got a better numbers than down south, so it has a little bit easier, but doesn't do as much as she used to be able to do. If she goes to the shops, it's just for one thing, and then gets in and gets out. No sort of shopping around. So it has made it very hard, and you wonder, well, what's going to happen, but that's part of life, so you just have to deal with it. As I said, well, my main things is I do try, and once a week I go to restorative yoga class, and that usually involves about half an hour of meditation in the 2 to 2.5 session. I also go to a very call it boutique sort of gym, so we all sort of know one another, so that's very good, and do a couple of classes there, which is called LDOA. I know this is sort of going off from PAH, but it's a myofascial release class, and to me it's one of the best classes that I would make sure I do the two classes per week, because I find it helps with preventing my back having playing up or my neck and that sort of thing. So I just don't usually go on about what exercise to do, but I just found for me it's one of the best classes out. And the other thing I do is swimming as well. It's been hard, like I said before, with the COVID, not letting a lot of people come in, so into our unit. So mainly just on the telephone or via messages, I sort of keep in contact with other people. So I don't, if we're having someone. Oh, and that's, unfortunately, that's Bridget's always, that's all she's ever known since she was born, to be in that, not frame of mind, but in that position of always having a chronic illness. So she's never known what it's like to be well. She knows what it's like to be well for her, but not compared to someone else. So, she's missed out a lot of a lot of opportunities. She did get into university, but only lasted about a week. And she was going to be teaching, primary school teaching, majoring in to be a music teacher. But it was just too much within going in and out of hospital. Occasionally I go to a psychologist, and the one I'd last went to, the same things they tell me. As in, when Bridget was in the neonatal intensive care, the nurse used to say, you have to spend time on yourself. And I've always found that very, very hard. But that's the same thing the psychologist said to me. You have to, with looking after my mother and my daughter and my husband going off to look after, it's hard to find that time to spend on yourself when you know there's so many other things you need to do for other people. But like the psychologist says, if you don't look after yourself, who's going to look after the people that you care for if you're unwell yourself? That's probably, so basically do as I say, don't do as I do. That's the main thing I need to finish off with there. Righto, thanks, Brigida.
Thank you so much for that, Robyn. I can't tell you how much we appreciate you sharing your story with us today. I'm sure everyone online with us will have taken a lot from that account that you've provided and what it's like on the inside supporting a loved one with PAH. I know certainly a number of people will resonate with those difficulties you've talked about, like the long road to diagnosis, and just that grief you experience when the whole landscape of your future is altered. And hopefully we'll all heed that reminder to look after ourselves as well. So that brings us to the Q&A segment. I can see that we do have some questions coming through already. So I will just remind everybody that responses to the questions today will be of a general nature only. So we'd certainly still recommend you seek advice from your treating healthcare team as well. So the first one we've got through, I think, probably is for you, Jane. We have somebody wanting to know if you refer patients to pulmonary rehabilitation.
Yes, I do. I'm the one who sort of is conducting the 6-minute walk tests and looking at whether or not people need oxygen, because I use a blue night recorder that while they do the walk test, they are having a little ear probe, which I found much better than a finger probe. And I can see how high their heart rate, the PAH patient's heart rate runs, and how low their saturations run. And then I can also have a look to see how their walking is. Are they unsteady on their feet? And generally speaking, we know that if you don't use it, you're going to lose it. And that is my emphasis on every visit that the patient comes to. And I do refer to our pulmonary hypertension rehab, and that's run at the Royal 2 days a week. And people find it very beneficial if you do attend that Tuesday, Thursday session, which is difficult to get into. Anybody who is heading for lung transplant, I've had the pleasure of working with three people who have had successful lung transplants. They have to do pulmonary rehab, but often I will ask patients if they would like to attend, because it's always a choice. Your care is your choice, but I know people will get great benefit from that pulmonary rehab. But of course, money can be a restriction, and one has to be seen that they'll have commitment to that.
Thank you, Jane, and I hope that answers it for the asker. If you'd like to keep your questions coming in, everybody, we do have another one that's been sent in. This person is worried that by talking too much to their partner about her health, that it will excessively worry her, especially when they've recently gotten some not so great news at an appointment. So they're wanting to know how they should go about bringing up those more difficult topics. They know that they're worrying and that their partner who lives with PAH closes up, but this person as a carer is worried too and just wants to speak about them. I suppose this one could be directed at either of you.
Yeah, I find my daughter, she doesn't want to know much at all, but I want to know everything. So it's probably a bit different, and my husband has his own health problems, and Yeah, that's very, it's very tricky. I found when we've had a problem, my daughter sees a psychologist for the congenital heart team at the hospital. And when she has a difficult problem that involves me, I tend to get asked to come along, and it's good to have a sort of that third person as a mediator type of thing to actually get people to talk. To me, yeah, probably best if you know they may talk, probably get somebody else who has the ability to draw things out of them and to question put the questions in the right sort of way that they would be happy to answer as well.
Yeah, that is a tough one. I think that's some great advice there too, though, Robyn, with a mediator. I think it's always helpful.
Certainly that question of me being female and a carer, yeah, and a mother, I want to talk it all out. I want to make sure everybody, you know, voices their opinions. And, you know, if you're pushing somebody into a situation they feel uncomfortable with, that's where, yes, I agree with Robyn, mediator time. And I think, though, that the beauty of life is when you can care, you can laugh together, but you can also cry together, and you can talk about the fact that nobody gets to live forever. And I think to talk about, what are we going to do in between? And what do you want in the end? And what if I go first as the carer? And some of those questions are so challenging because they're so raw. But I do think there is a time and place for them, and maybe to have a mediator to help start to breach some of the, you know, cross over that bridge to talk about some of the tough stuff is necessary. But I think life becomes richer when you share your deep emotions.
Most definitely. Okay, thank you, Jane and Robyn. I hope that answers that for the person who was asking. Jane, we have another question for you. Somebody was just wondering if you could mention again that publication from the US regarding carers having to educate healthcare professionals.
Oh, yes.
Jane, sorry. Yeah. Called Pathlight.
Yeah. Thank you, Robyn. So I do have that particular article, and it's called Caregivers Who Asked You. And this particular article that I read, so I read all the different articles regularly to see if they might help people, and I pass them on. I have a bulletin board. And in that Caregivers article, Who Asked You, it's a very well-written article, and in that article it discusses the National Alliance for Caregivers, which is a long-established organization for people with PAH, and they send out surveys. And again, it gives carers a voice. In this particular article, it was just amazing, saying that 90% of carers and patients were educating nurses or doctors about what PAH is. And certainly when I start my patients on epoprostenol, I've made up for them, I call it the Bible or the goal book. And I say, you know, this is going to help you tell everybody exactly what you have and how, what needs to be done in emergency. So take it with you. You know, I'm not, you know, Bible, gold book, it's just a high standard. And I said, you take your extra pump with you, and don't be angry that they don't know about it. Be sharing and caring and giving. And, you know, try and let go of your anger, or reboot that anger into positiveness, because too many things in life can just drag us down the gurgler if we let anger and frustration dominate us.
Okay, thank you. Again, some great advice there. Another question, this one I suppose can be for either of you once again. How do you find time for yourself when you're worried about your loved one?
When we were in the States, we knew my mother's advanced care directive. We knew what she wanted. And that meant that we had support from my brother and sister-in-law, so that if we were going out to a movie, they could step in. How do you find time for yourself? Well, sometimes you have to let go and have faith that people can look after themselves and have a plan of how they can manage without you. Because often in that care role, you have that great fear that if you're not there, everything's going to fall apart. And you know, that risk is real for you, but it's probably overdone. And you have to be willing to let go. And just say, I'm going to take an hour out to go for a walk or go for yoga or do my yoga. And this is the best time of day to do it. So again, you're giving up what might be your preferred time of day. But planning, just planning into your day or your week or wherever you can manage it, that moment of time, though, that couple of hours for you, whether it be getting a friend or family, or there is respite that can be available for people through NDIS. So it's there. You have to search for it, though. It's not going to land in your lap.
Okay, thank you. We've had another one come in again anonymously. Somebody is wanting to know how they can manage their own worries about the future that they share with their loved one and their family.
Well, yeah, well, I can tell people what to do. It's a matter of living in the day. You can't do anything about what's going to happen in the future. Yeah, just sort of, and mindfulness is a good way to help you get there as well, just sort of focusing on what you can do and don't have all that mind, the chatter, that monkey, what they call the monkey voice, and that going in there saying, oh, what if this happens, what if that happens. It's a matter of trying to think, well, I'll deal with it if it happens, if it doesn't happen, great. But yes, it's just sort of trying to just focus on the one thing that you're doing and not try to worry about other things that may not ever happen. It took me a while, but the last couple of years, I won't, like with my LDOA classes, it's only for 3/4 hours twice a week, I won't move on that. I don't care what other people have got appointments or anything like that. That's my LDOA time, and I'm not doing anything. You know, I ring up and make an appointment for my mother and they say, oh, I've got such and such. So, oh, no, so I've got an appointment myself that time. I have to do it some... Now, this is only the last couple of years this has happened, so it's small steps that you have to take and just one thing and, you know, try and just do a little bit, make some changes slowly.
Oh, yeah. One step at a time.
Yes.
Jane, did you have anything to add, or we'll move on to, I think we've got time for maybe one last question.
Yeah, no, I think that's so true, is just start with, you know, what you can do for the day. Plan your day, and you might go to plan D, E, F, G, but plan what you want, plan A, and then work it.
Okay, thank you, Jane and Robyn. Okay, final question, I think this can be answered by either of you again. Somebody has said, some days I think I'm going all right, and others the sheer endurance of being a carer leaves me feeling burnt out. I don't get breaks ever, really, because it isn't possible. We have no other help available. How can I avoid burnout? And now we have touched on this briefly about finding time, but I don't know if anyone had anything else to add.
It's possibly, you know, going to those sites to find out how people make time for themselves, the carers' sites in Lung Foundation. What do you think, Robyn?
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's like it took me for respite for my daughter outside of the home. It took me a couple of years to actually find a place because they're all for people with intellectual or mental health disabilities, and to find a place that was just for people with physical disabilities but not intellectually. It was hard work, but it's just, you just keep, I don't know, it's a lot of work, but I just kept ringing different places, and some people were very good. They said, oh, ring this one might be able to help you, and eventually we found a place. But yeah, it's just perseverance. Yeah, get on to, it all depends what area that person lives in Australia, because now there are, we got carers Queensland, but now, because of the Australian government, April this year, We've got another organisation now that looks after carers called Wellways. So it's a matter of trying to find out about the care organisations looking after people too, to even get onto the social worker at the hospital. Maybe that might be a start as well. Or your local member. I know my, I'm all my federal member. He's very good. Yeah, just keep ringing different ones. If this one doesn't help, try someone else. And like I said, they might say, okay, ring this one. And they might say, ring this one. You eventually, well, we did anyway in the long run.
Yeah, okay, definitely. Lots of different avenues to explore there anyway. Thank you. I think that will bring us to the end of the webinar now. So thank you to both of our speakers today, Jane and Robyn. We so appreciate you taking the time to join us and share some of your knowledge and insights. I do hope that everyone listening was able to gain something from today's session. Please know if there's anything further you're needing help with, our information and support centre is ready for your call. So please do get in touch via those details on your screen. If yourselves as carers or patients or anyone else impacted by lung disease has any questions at all, just reach out to us. Please look after yourselves, your loved ones and each other, and we'll see you next time.